Thanks. I got my 10,000 hours in sort of maybe a little unfairly early. I started, when it all go wrong. I started the cello. This is on the day of my first ever concert. Probably my best concert, actually, because it was very short. And at that point, the left hand was simply there to hold the cello on whilst I sat there wearing short pants. And this became something of a theme, really. This is arriving in Philadelphia with my band. I'm still in short pants. America at the time was very exciting for me because it really was an alien country. I mean, people spoke weird. They ate really strange food. Star Wars had just come out. It was awesome. And being in New York in 1979 was an experience I think I'll never forget. But I was obsessed with the idea of actually pushing it further than just playing the cello in concerts. I really wanted to actually push my limits. So I got my Snoopy-headed notepaper, and I wrote a letter, a very serious letter. I mean, it was joined up writing and everything, to the London Symphony Orchestra saying, "Dear London Symphony Orchestra, can I please join the London Symphony Orchestra? I really like the London Symphony Orchestra. Yours since, could never spell it, best wishes, love, Philip, X, 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 X." The bastards never wrote back to me. Nonetheless, I persevered, formed a beat combo, string quartet, still short pants. So wearing long trousers now. And I really kind of carried on doing that, really. The hair changed, the pants got longer. We thought we were Oasis, just go with it. But the main thing that I learned to do at the Royal Academy of Music, and I've been there since I was 6 years old, was I learned to play music by dead white people. I was fully qualified to play music by dead white people. I mean, and I knew this was the career that I was going to follow because playing music by dead white people is really where it's at. Right? Well, I knew it wasn't really because there was something missing. And people think of music as being a creative art form, and it is, except classical music is the one thing you can go through and study without actually ever creating anything of your own, apart from interpretations. And I realized, actually, you can write your own music. Because, you know, if you don't, it's a bit like being a race driver and not actually being remotely interested how the engine works. That seems to be slightly ludicrous. So I said to my teacher, who was 76, and had stopped playing at the age of 20, because that's what her husband had told her to do. I said, I think I really, really want to compose music. She was sitting there in her chaise longue. She looked me up and down, and she said, "We do not do that." So why not? You can't do that. Now, when someone says you can't do that to you, do you know what it actually means? It means I don't want you to do that. Honestly. Now, it might be that it's a teacher or mentor. It might be that it's a colleague at work. It might actually even be one of your family. But whenever you hear you can't do that, just think, I think you're telling me what you're trying to say. Sound like I'm mansplaining now. What I think you're trying to say is you don't want me to do that. And that always rings alarm bells for me. And I know that in writing music, getting stuff on the page, that's where the goosebumps kick in. And the moment you play something, that's when everything kind of viscerally takes off and it becomes terribly exciting. Now, around this time, I met Dave. This is Dave. And I was asked to write some music for a movie, and this is Commander Dave Scott, and he was involved in it. Now, Dave, Yeah, I think so. Dave was someone who clearly no one had said you can't do that to. I mean, he was an astronaut. I mean, he drove a buggy on the moon. And at the time I thought, well, I can either follow this or I can follow that. I think I pretty much know I want to do that. Not become an astronaut, that's too difficult. We'll hear about that later. But I want to actually be near people who take visceral risks and who live a little bit more in extremis. And I got to write music for a movie, and we worked closely with the Apollo astronauts, which is kind of astounding. Met six of them within the space of 2 weeks. And the people who commissioned the film watched the movie. And bear in mind, none of us had made a film before. We didn't really know what we were doing. But it's a great subject. Where can you go wrong? And they watched the film, and the feedback was, yeah, there's a great movie in here. It's not this. This is not a great movie. I thought, oh. But, you know, in our hearts, we knew there was something there. So we entered it for a small festival in Utah, and we won Sundance. And then we kept winning. We won 8 different film festivals in a row. At which point, the person who said there was a good film in there said, I knew all along, absolutely knew all along, it was a winner. And they made a lot of money. We didn't. But from that point on, I realized, maybe there's something in this. Maybe I need to kind of make a bit of a shift. Stop being in string quartets, start writing music. And I found myself in recording studios, Air Studios, Abbey Road, because once you've done one half-decent film, then people think, oh, who can write music for this documentary? We'll get that guy. And I was just writing all the time. But all the time I had this imposter syndrome. I'd be standing in front of an orchestra, and I'm thinking they're going to know that I've never had a conducting lesson in my life. I've never had a composition lesson in my life. I just play the cello. And when people say, what do you do? I say, well, I play the cello and I write music a bit. And I was really embarrassed about it. And when this photo was taken in Air Studios, I was conducting away, kind of, you know, the right hand just does this and the left hand turns pages. That's all a left hand ever does for a conductor. It's all it needs to do. And I felt this presence behind me. There's someone standing behind me. That's really rude in a recording session. And I was trying to look around and see this elderly gentleman, who's sort of like quite tall, stopped the take. I turned around. Shit. It's George Martin. And I looked at him. He looked at me. He said, no, carry on, dear boy. It's very nice. It's lovely. I thought, well, if he doesn't know it's crap, maybe there's something in this. So I get more and more films that go to Sundance, and I find myself sitting in this next to this handsome chap. And we've got a film there about this guy called Pat Tillman, who was an amazing character, I'm sure a lot of you know. And it's a difficult movie, and we need, as with any film festival, we're trying to sell the rights to this film. And we know that this guy's interested. This is Harvey Weinstein. Harvey is notorious for several things. Being very successful, winning lots of Oscars, being a great guy. That's some of them. The other thing is, whenever he buys a movie, he fires the composer and commissions music that he likes. So I thought, I'm going to get fired if he buys this movie. And I'm sitting next to him at the screening. I'm English. I'm conflicted at this point. So I'm sitting there, and, you know, movie finishes. I say, Harvey! And he goes, yeah, what? So, what do you think of the film? I liked it. Oh, good. Music's a bit shit, isn't it? And he looked at me like, no, I like the music. I said, well, that's good, because I wrote it. This isn't being streamed, is it? I mean, we're fine. Okay, good. Sometimes being offensive is actually the best strategy, as in going out there and turning fired to hired. I mean, it's just not that hard to do. And at that point, I've never felt more alive in my life. Never more so than when I was told that story back a year later by someone else. There was this composer, like, that was me. Many more like that. Let's not go there. I came across, in doing documentaries, so many people who lived actually, as I was saying before, in this extremist, on this edge, in this difficult situation, actually doing things where they might die, or where they might be in a situation where they're in a sort of ecstatic state, or whether they are in extreme distress. This is Jimmy Chin. Now, Jimmy I got to know through doing movies for North Face and other people like that. And he had made a film called Meru, which is absolutely astounding. I mean, this guy is one of the greatest photographers in the world, but he's photographing other mountaineers and often going ahead of them and actually doing more difficult climbs than the people he's actually portraying as heroes. And I'd just like to play you one piece from the movie. This is the final track that I wrote for the film. Can I just turn the monitor down a little bit in the cello? Thanks. I don't know what that meant when I said it, but it sounded right. Okay. I got fired from that movie. just to be honest. But the weird thing was, and I was happy to be fired because it just wasn't working out, that I ended up actually placing more music in the film than if I'd actually written it originally and then charging them a lot more for it, which was an important business lesson. I've just finished my 60th movie. We premiered this at the weekend in Toronto. And I now feel kind of more at home in a studio. I still feel a bit of an imposter, but I don't actually know what all those buttons do. I don't. But the guy standing next to me, Andrew Dudman, who's probably the greatest recording engineer in the world, always shows me a new button every time I'm in there. I'm deadly serious. The trick is to employ and engage people who know more than you and are better than you. And I'm really happy doing that. Very happy to admit it. Thank you. I'm by far the least skilled person in my organization. I think that's a pretty good place to be because I'll only ever get pulled up. At the same time, around film number 30, the Royal Academy of Music, who had said don't, can't, won't, awarded me a fellowship, which you give to white people who are nearly dead. At which point I thought, I need to leave the Royal Academy of Music and run away and join the circus, which I did. This is Las Vegas, this is Cirque du Soleil. I'm not the guy on his hands. I am the decomposing composer, however. And people could die in this situation. And actually, it was an extraordinary privilege to join a company. And I thought, someone's going to know I don't know what I'm doing. But actually, everybody felt like that. And it didn't matter. As long as you're good at what you did, and you always said, I'm really sorry, I don't understand, or that rope's breaking, you were honest and called out things when they weren't right, you were fine. No one was going to die. They made me a lovely cello. Weirdly enough, it didn't make it through customs. And then I started hitting the bucket list hard. I worked on the Beijing Olympics. And for that, I was standing in front of the London Symphony Orchestra in Abbey Road Studios. I'd written to this orchestra in 1979 on Snoopy paper saying, I want to be in the London Symphony Orchestra. And now I was conducting them. They're going to know. They're going to know I don't know what I'm doing. This is really bad. I'm still very pissed off that they didn't write back to me, but they know. And I remembered something someone had told me, which is, let them do the first take, say nothing. Look at the music, sigh. And then scan the back desks of the orchestra and say, I think we'd better try that again. Do you know what happened? Every single one of them went, oh, he realized. The adrenaline kicked in, and it sounded it already sounded great, but I couldn't say that. Now, I do want you to try this in your organizations, is to go, I'm serious. Because you're not criticizing. It's very English. Say it in an English accent. I think we'd better try that again. It's like, well done, dear, but maybe one more time. It works every damn time. Especially when you think, I don't know what I'm talking about. I promise you it works. Don't do it in a restaurant. Don't do it in a restaurant, ever. I then worked on the London 2012 Olympics, and this is the lesson I learned. The bigger the event, there were 2.5 billion people watching, and I was working with 206 different countries to rewrite their national anthems for the next 25 years. Another story, nightmare. I learned this. The bigger the project, the less anybody knows. Nobody knows anything. But you try and put up a bus stop in the main street, it's going to take you longer than it took the Americans to get a man on the moon. Fact, because everybody knows something about it. That's a massively important lesson. And actually, it means the bigger the project, the more you need to be strong. You might be wrong, but be strong, lead firmly, and then you can always say, we're going to change direction drastically here. It's fine. It works, I promise you. You know this. I also decided I was going to lighten up a little bit as well. This is Harry Parry, who lives in Santa Monica. This is me having just told him that he needed to stop being so shy, because I've learned now I need to talk to everybody that I see who I think is more extrovert than me and learn something from them. And this guy, I think, pretty much exemplifies it. He's loaded, by the way. That's a fact. In the financial sense. Now, American and English are different languages, aren't they? I'm learning this. The 9-year-old me then would have been excited that my bucket list took another turn for the weird, which is that on my list, and I'm in the habit now of telling people what my list is. I said, I really want to work with J.J. Abrams on Star Wars. And he ended up using my music for the Star Wars trailer, which sounds like this. Well, it looks like this. It doesn't sound like that. But that's the music that ended up being used for the Force Awakens trailer. So that one was ticked off the list. Simply because I'd told people, and there were 5 different introductions to him within about a month. It was ridiculous. But there's a dark side. It's really weird. People who are really skilled and really good at what they do are really nice. There's a massive layer, particularly in classical music, of people who are just pretty spiteful. And I had 6 death threats the first time I worked on the London Olympics, which is weird, because I don't really think it was that offensive. But misinformation, Rupert Murdoch's newspapers, Mexican TV station really getting their translations wrong, meant I got doorstepped by tabloids. And still now, I get 6 hate emails a week, which is about music that I write, not necessarily about anthems, which is kind of weird. Now, that can actually get to you a bit, and thanks to people like the Hatch Network, I can actually get through it without kind of, being maudlin about it. But here's another important lesson, and I think this is true. I might change my mind next week. But I believe your work is not you, and you are not your work. I think you pour everything into your work. But similarly, if someone says to you, I think what you play is amazing, you say, well, thank you, but that was that, and that's it. Similarly, if they say, I don't like what you do, say, fair enough. That's why I'm happy to be fired, because I can turn and look at a piece of music and say, yeah, it's not very good actually, is it? But it's not a sin. It's not mortally wrong. It's fine. There's a separation. And I think that's a critically important lesson to learn. It's weird, because the moment then you get affirmation from the industry, I now can apparently watch films for nothing and get a vote from the Oscars, which means somehow I've been accepted, makes me think I need to leave. I'm serious. The moment the industry says, you are one of us, I'm not sure I want to be one of you. Hey, don't get me wrong, the little black card gets me into movie theaters. I'm totally cool with that. That's fine. Thank you very much, and the parties are awesome. But similarly as with the Royal Academy of Music, the moment you get the affirmation, you have to think, maybe I'm doing something wrong now. Serious question. So my way of actually changing it up is to try and challenge the way that I work. I want to now run an inventions company, which I've started. I'm a CEO of a thing that's been compared to being the Instagram of music. We'll see. I don't know. But anyway, it's an exciting adventure. But I want to just put my words on the line a little bit here. And I don't know what I'm going to play to finish with. It's going to be very short. Don't worry. I'm a great believer in having a grounding, that's like the early days, then having that mountain to climb, kind of professionally, where you learn, and then the moment you get into clear air, which is I think what we're talking about with the S-curves and things like that, the moment you actually go free and you take that risk and you make that jump back down again, that's exhilarating. All you stand to lose is your reputation, credibility, probably money, hope, and time. I'm cool with that. It's your time. So I don't know what I'm going to play, so let's do this easily. I need a note to start on. Can someone shout out a note if they know one? I didn't know my mum was in. Okay, so E flat. Let's have one more. Let's have another one. D. Yes, E flat and D. Okay, that sounds like this. These are good notes. It's in here somewhere. Okay, maybe one more. C. Oh, that's nice. So that's probably enough for a piece. Okay. And what's your name, madam?
Oh, Kelly.
O. Kelly. This is O. Kelly. It's like R. Kelly, but earlier. I'm sure you've had lots of music written about you. This is called O. Kelly, and thank you very much for listening.